Today we will be discussing neurosyphilis and one of its latent manifestations, Tabes dorsalis. The learning objectives of this presentation will include reviewing the late neurologic manifestations of syphilis, understanding the mechanism by which treponema pallidum causes neuronal injury, identifying the clinical manifestations of late neurosyphilis, and reviewing the laboratory studies needed in making a diagnosis of neurosyphilis. Lastly, we will discuss the standard treatments of neurosyphilis. We will review the epidemiology, pathophysiology, clinical manifestations, diagnosis, and treatment of this disease. Neurosyphilis refers to an infection of the central nervous system by the spirochete treponema pallidum. The term neurosyphilis is used to describe any of six neurosyphilitic syndromes. Early on, these include asymptomatic neurosyphilis, acute symptomatic neurosyphilis, and meningovasculitis, while late manifestations include parenchymatous neurosyphilis, under which dementia paralytica and tabes dorsalis fall, CNS gumata, and congenital neurosyphilis. In the pre-antibiotic era, 25-30% of patients presented with neurosyphilis, with the most common manifestation being tabes dorsalis. Since the widespread use of antibiotics, asymptomatic and early neurosyphilis have been more common, including syphilitic meningitis, meningovasculitis, and syphilitic eye disease. These are more frequently seen in patients with HIV infections, particularly those with lower CD4 T-cell counts. Neurosyphilis begins with the invasion of the cerebral spinal fluid by the spirochete treponema pallidum, which occurs early in the course of the infection. As a result, clinical neurosyphilis can present at any time beyond the primary stage. A cellular hypersensitivity reaction is thought to be triggered. However, the body's immune response is not sufficient to be protective, but substantial enough to cause tissue damage. This inflammatory response leads to perivascular infiltration of the meninges with lymphocytes and plasma cells, producing focal meningeal inflammation that can lead to hypertrophic meninges or gumata. Perivascular infiltration of the arteries produces arteritis, luminal occlusion, thrombosis, and stroke. These are secondary manifestations. Spontaneous resolution of the infection may occur in some cases, but patients with persistent meningitis are more likely to develop manifestations of tertiary neurosyphilis. About 1/3 of patients with untreated latent syphilis develop tertiary manifestations after a variable period ranging from months to years. Late neurosyphilis results from chronic inflammation with parenchymal involvement, causing neuronal degeneration and gliosis. This manifests in two ways, namely dementia paralytica and tabes dorsalis. In dementia paralytica, there is brain atrophy, loss of cortical architecture, meningeal thickening, and ventricular dilatation. In tabes dorsalis, the lesions are characteristically concentrated in the dorsal roots and dorsal columns of the spinal cord at the lumbosacral and lower thoracic areas. The preganglionic portion of the spinal cord is infiltrated by lymphocytes and plasma cells, resulting in atrophy of the posterior columns. On gross examination, there is diffuse meningeal thickening greater over the dorsal than ventral surface of the cord, diffuse lymphocytic and plasma cell infiltration of the leptomeninges, flattening of the cord due to atrophy of the dorsal columns, and diffuse demyelination of the posterior columns and degeneration of the dorsal roots, which appear gray throughout their width, as demonstrated on the right. In early neurosyphilis, the clinical manifestations can be variable. In asymptomatic neurosyphilis, there is an absence of neurologic signs or symptoms. However, the spinal fluid is abnormal and shows a mild lymphocytic or mononuclear pleocytosis, elevated protein, and a reactive VDRL. Acute symptomatic syphilitic meningitis and ocular syphilis usually occur within the first year of infection, but can also occur years later. The most common symptoms include nausea, vomiting, headache, neck stiffness, and cranial nerve abnormalities, and the spinal fluid again shows an elevated opening pressure, lymphocytic pleocytosis, an elevated protein, a lower normal glucose, and a positive VDRL. Meningovascular syphilis occurs 5 to 7 years after the initial infection. Patients typically present with focal neurologic signs related to a stroke or transverse myelitis. This results from a focal obliterative vasculitis of the small and medium-sized vessels and associated meningeal irritation, and can occur within the cerebral as well as intraspinal arteries. The spinal fluid also shows the same typical abnormalities, namely an isolated elevation of protein, mild pleocytosis, and a reactive VDRL. Cerebral angiography shows diffuse narrowing of the intracerebral arteries and arterioles, while head imaging shows multiple areas of infarction. Late or tertiary neurosyphilis typically presents in one of two ways, namely dementia paralytica or Tabes dorsalis. Both are associated with spinal fluid abnormalities, which consist of one or more of the following: a positive EDRL, an elevated protein, or lymphocytic pleocytosis. Dementia paralytica typically occurs 10 to 20 years after the initial infection. It is characterized by a slow deterioration of cognitive function that affects memory, insight and judgment, and language, weakness in the arms or legs, a tremor, pupillary abnormalities, and a loss of bowel or bladder control. Tabes dorsalis occurs 15 to 20 years from the time of the initial infection. It is characterized by radicular paresthesias or dysesthesias, lancinating pain that is sudden, brief, and can affect the limbs, back, or face, loss of proprioception and vibratory sensation that results in a sensory ataxia and a broad-based or foot-slapping gait, absent reflexes in the lower limbs, and pupillary irregularities. The typical pupillary finding is called an Argall-Robertson pupil and consists of a small pupil with loss of pupillary reaction to light, which is preserved to accommodation. In making a diagnosis of neurosyphilis, serum non-treponemal tests, which include RPR and VDRL, may be non-reactive, particularly in Tabes dorsalis. Only approximately 70% of people with neurosyphilis have a positive VDRL. Serum treponemal tests should always be performed when there is a concern for late neurosyphilis. These include fluorescent treponemal antibody absorption, treponemopalatum particle agglutination assay, and syphilis enzyme immunoassay. These tests remain reactive for life regardless of prior treatment. Patients with non-reactive serum treponemal tests do not merit further evaluation for late neurosyphilis. However, a lumbar puncture should be performed in patients with reactive serum treponemal tests. The typical CSF abnormalities include lymphocytic pleocytosis, an elevated protein, a low or normal glucose, and a reactive CSF VDRL. A reactive CSF VDRL establishes a diagnosis, but a non-reactive one does not exclude it. When the CSF VDRL is negative, a CSF FTA antibody should be obtained. If this is non-reactive, then neurosyphilis is excluded. The drugs of choice for treatment of neurosyphilis include penicillin G and penicillin G procaine. Penicillin G is administered intravenously over a period of 10 to 14 days, while penicillin G procaine is administered intramuscularly along with probenecid over the same period of time. Alternative antibiotics include ceftriaxone. In patients with a history of a penicillin allergy, they should be skin set tested and desensitized. The initial CSF pleocytosis will resolve within 6 months after penicillin therapy in 80% of patients. In summary, neurosyphilis refers to a CNS infection by the spirochete treponemopalatum. Early neurosyphilis manifests as meningitis, stroke, or transverse myelitis, while tertiary or late neurosyphilis manifests as Tabes dorsalis and dementia paralytica. Tabes dorsalis results from inflammation of the dorsal roots and ganglia and degeneration of the posterior columns. Patients with Tabes dorsalis experience radicular, thunderpult pain and develop a broad-based foot-slapping gait and pupillary abnormalities. Serum treponemal tests are often needed in the diagnosis, and CSF treponemal tests are required. Penicillin G is the recommended treatment. I hope you have found this presentation informative. Below, I have attached some useful references for further exploration.